سكند توك نيورو اندوكراين تيومرز ان تانجلينج ذا تانجلز. البروفيسور دكتور خالد نوعم بروفيسور اوف ريديو دايجنوزيس الكسندريا يونيفرسيتي ورئيس القسم.
This is the laser pointer. The laser pointer ولا ايه؟ في ليزر بوينتر ولا ايه؟ اوكي. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. My presentation today is about imaging of the neuroendocrinal tumors. Actually, the nuclear medicine is important in particular clinical contexts, and it is indispensable like some of the examinations in radiology, although the tremendous advances cannot be replaced by others, like the hysterosalpingogram. If you want to assess the patency of the fallopian tube, it's impossible to do it except with this basic examination, which is the hysterosalpingogram. Also, there are some lesions in the body which are notorious for being very small in crowded areas, and it will be tough to figure out where these lesions, except when you will light it and let it show up among the crowded background. For example, the parathyroid adenomas, which are usually sub-centimeter, and it may be problematic when it affects all the gland in the context of hyperplasia. Another particularly difficult group of lesions is the neuroendocrinal tumors, which are usually small, notoriously present in the abdomen among other organs, and it's a very tough job to identify it with the anatomical imaging, with the CT or the MRI. So you need to do another examination which will make it pop up and will be easily visualized. To start with, we have to understand some basic definitions. What is the neuroendocrinal cell? The neuroendocrinal cell was identified in 1969 as the apodoma cells, and hence the name of the tumors which was previously used to describe these tumors is apodomas, amine precursor uptake and decarboxylation. The apodoma cells were defined as producing polypeptide hormones and amines identical to those found in the neurons. In 1994, Langley made a more precise definition of the neuroendocrinal cell as a cell producing neurotransmitter, neuromediator, or peptide hormone. The sympathetic nervous system is derived from the neural crest cells, which are multipotent stem cells at the sides of the neural tube. It comprises the adrenal medulla and the nervous ganglia from the skull base to the pelvis. Neuroendocrinal tumors arises from the neuroendocrinal cells, which are distributed in different organ system. Example, the pancreas, the adrenal medulla, the GIT, and they secrete amines, and hence this is the part of the term neuroendocrinal tumors. The amines produced acts as hormones, endocrine function, and neurotransmitter neurological function, so they are termed neuroendocrinal tumors to highlight the association between the neuro property and the endocrinal property of the cells. The amines include serotonin and catecholamines. The catecholamines are namely epinephrine, norepinephrine, and dopamine. The polypeptide hormones are also secreted by the neuroendocrinal tumors, like the somatostatin, and lastly, the functional hormones, particularly in the gastrointestinal tract, including insulin and glucagon. Neuroendocrinal tumors are broadly classified into tumors arising from the tympanoadrenal lineage, namely neuroblastoma, phacochromocytoma, and paragangliomas. Neuroendocrinal tumors of the gastroenteropancreatic duct or tract, including carcinoids and pancreatic neuroendocrinal tumors. The carcinoids arises from the enterochromaffin cells, while the pancreatic endocrine tumors arises from different cells distributed in the pancreas and along the gastrointestinal tract, including gastrinoma, insulinomas, VIPomas, glucagonomas, and somatostatinomas. Other neuroendocrinal tumors are neuroendocrinal tumors of the lung, which are non-small cell cancers, pituitary tumors, and medullary thyroid carcinoma. Neuroendocrinal tumors are notoriously associated with some syndromes, namely MEN1, MEN2, familial medullary thyroid carcinoma, and other MEN syndromes like the familial paraganglioma syndromes. As we previously addressed, the localization of neuroendocrinal tumors is extremely difficult with the anatomical imaging. So you resort either to the SPECT or the PET, and as Gabe pointed out the differences between SPECT and PET. In the SPECT, you rely upon radiotracer. In the PET, you rely upon positron-emitting radionuclei. Both tracers, the tracers in the PET and the SPECT, are either specific or non-specific. The specific tracers, they tackle the catecholamine synthesis, uptake, and storage. So they are targeting the catecholamine metabolism, while the non-specific tracers are targeting metabolism or somatostatin expression. Specific SPECT tracers are radio-labeled single photon emitters involved in catecholamine synthesis, uptake, and storage, the most famous of which is indium-123 and indium-131 MIBG. The normal distribution of MIBG is encountered in the salivary glands, the liver, the spleen, the myocardium, the lungs may or may not be visualized. The kidney is usually, if encountered, activity, it will be identified early, thyroid and stomach, if free radioiodine is present. And lastly, in delayed image, the colon may be identified. The normal adrenals are uncommonly and faintly visualized. And this may create a problem. If they got visualized, you may be in trouble. If this is physiologic uptake or this is a tumor. Another variant which is encountered with the MIBG imaging is similar to that encountered with the FDG imaging, which is the uptake in the brown fat, notoriously encountered in the supraclavicular regions and the axillary regions. As we can see in this image, here there is activity along the supraclavicular regions related to the presence of brown fat. The uptake of MIBG is dependent on what is known as the noradrenaline transport system, which is responsible basically for the uptake of epinephrine and norepinephrine. The MIBG is analog for the epinephrine and norepinephrine, so it will be taken by the neuroblastoma or the pheochromocytoma in proportion to the activity of the noradrenaline transport system, in addition to the number of storage vesicles present within the cells of the tumor. These are some examples of pheochromocytoma. Here we can see this heterogeneously enhancing lesion in the gadolinium-enhanced MRI. In the MIBG, it displays intense activity, and it was proved to be a pheochromocytoma in a patient with von Hippel-Lindau disease. This is another case of pheochromocytoma in the T2-weighted image, heterogeneous intensity with cystic degeneration identified at this high signal on the MIBG CT SPECT. It lights up indicative that this is neuroblastoma, another a pretty necrotic and heterogeneous right adrenal lesion, and another left adrenal lesion. On the MIBG SPECT CT, the right one lights up, so it was proved to be pheochromocytoma, while the left didn't, and it was proved to be a pituitary, the right proved to be pheochromocytoma, while the left was proved to be pituitary adrenal adenoma. Another case of metastatic pheochromocytoma, a heterogeneous mass in the right hypochondrial region, known to be pheochromocytoma. malignant pheochromocytoma, and the CT also demonstrated an expansile lesion along the posterior aspect of a left rib, which was assumed to be metastatic deposit from the pheochromocytoma. The MIBG scan showed intense uptake by the rib lesion, so this is pheochromocytoma with metastatic deposit. And with the good uptake of the tracer in the tumor and the mets, you may be able to initiate IBG, MIBG 131, MIBG therapy. False negative exams are related to one of two things, either poor noradrenaline transport system or low number of storage vesicles in the cells of the tumor. So the false negative MIBG are either related to medications interfering with MIBG uptake or necrotic or dedifferentiated pheochromocytomas with low expression of the noradrenaline transport system and the storage vesicle. This is an example of a patient who had metastatic neuroblastoma. On the MIBG post-therapy, there was excellent response. However, this response was far more than clinically expected, and it raised suspicion that there is something wrong going on. So they ordered an FDG imaging PET-CT, which proved that metastatic disease is still present, but it was not taken up its non-MIBG avid metastatic deposits, probably related to the MIBG therapy. So this was a false negative positive response, false complete response after MIBG therapy. Non-specific SPECT agents are radio-labeled single photon emitters targeting metabolism or somatostatin expression. Somatostatin is an amino acid peptide present in the brain, peripheral neurons, endocrinal pancreas, and the GIT. The somatostatin receptors are encountered on cells of neuroendocrinal origin as well as many non-endocrinal, non-neural cells. Neuroendocrinal tumors are characterized by somatostatin receptors, which are somatostatin receptor type 1 to type 5. Somatostatin receptor type 2 is the most commonly expressed in neuroendocrinal tumors with less expression in selenomas. In selenomas are the only neuroendocrinal tumors with low expression of somatostatin receptors. Tumor with high expression of somatostatin receptors include sympathoadrenal system tumors, neuroblastoma, pheochromocytoma, and paragangliomas. And notoriously, the malignant pheochromocytoma and the paragangliomas overexpress somatostatin receptors, gastroenteropancreatic pancreatic tumors, including glucagonoma, VIPomas, and gastrinomas, as well as somatostatinomas, no in selenomas. Although it may express, but it is notorious, it is famous that in selenoma usually lack the somatostatin receptors. Other tumors are medullary thyroid carcinoma, pituitary adenoma, Merkel cell carcinoma, and small lung cancer. Due to the short half-life of somatostatin in serum, it's 2 to 3 minutes, they introduce synthetic somatostatin radiolabel analogs, usually radiolabeled with the octreotide, for somatostatin receptor imaging. The most famous of the somatostatin receptor analogs targeting the somatostatin receptors in the neuroendocrinal tumors is the indium octreotide, which is a somatostatin receptor, analog labeled with indium 111, allowing imaging of the somatostatin receptors, especially type 2 and type 5. Usually, they acquire 4 and 24 hours whole body imaging. Normal uptake is usually encountered. This is an abnormal case, but you can see the physiologic uptake in the liver, the spleen, the thyroid, the pituitary, the liver, and the kidneys. Some of them is somatostatin receptor mediated, and some is through the excretion mechanism. Pheochromocytomas can express somatostatin receptors, but it is mainly indicated in dedifferentiated tumors, which is MIBG negative, and in detecting metastasis. The uptake of the radio tracer can be scaled according to the Krenning score from grade 0 to grade 5, and if the uptake is more than 2, you may consider peptide receptor radiotherapy. One of the diagnostic considerations which may be confused, for example, we mentioned a lot of tumors. You may call it a neuroendocrinal tumor, but it is not. It's the Merkel cell carcinoma, which is a highly aggressive cutaneous malignancy with aggressive behavior, and it is characterized by abundant somatostatin receptor expression. And this is an octillary scan from a patient with Merkel cell carcinoma revealing active uptake in the right axilla and right aspect of the chest wall, as well as in the left side of the neck and the left parotid gland. Now we are going to move to the PET molecules. I'm getting to be running out of time that fast. Okay, I excuse for extra 10 minutes. هو في محاضرة في الآخر canceled بتاع الدكتور هاني. For 5 to 10 minutes, and I will go fast as much as possible. The specific PET molecules are radiolabeled positron ligands, which are involved in catecholamine synthesis uptake. The main difference, it's radio tracer. Here, it's positron emitting. The most famous of which is the carbon labeled radiopharmaceutical, like the carbon 11 adrenaline, or the fluorine labeled radiopharmaceutical, which is much more commonly used, the most important of which is F18 fluorodopamine or F18 dihydroxyphenylalanine F18 DOPA. And here is a couple of examples of right pheochromocytoma with the F18 fluorodopamine PET, and this is a right pheochromocytoma with the F18 DOTA PET. Actually, the dihydroxyphenylalanine gets metabolized to dopamine, and the dopamine is the precursor of catecholamines, ending with the story that it will be taken up by the tumor based on the apodoma characteristic of the tumor, amine uptake, decarboxylate, and storage of the DOPA. Non-specific agent is our positron emitter ligands, and a major leap forward was the introduction of somatostatin analogs labeled with PET tracer, not with SPECT tracer. These, the most famous of which is the gallium 68, so positron emitting radionuclide gallium 68 for PET of tumors expressing somatostatin receptors. First advantage, you don't need an on-site cyclotron for production of gallium. It can be eluted from commercial generator. Gallium 68 DOTA peptide consists of three components. Very important to understand the complicated name of the tracer. You need to know what's lie beneath. It's composed of octreotide with affinity for the somatostatin receptor. This is the biological active part of the compound. Another part is the chelator, which is the DOTA. And the third part is the radio metal, which is the gallium 69. So the combination of the three has come into three famous complexes used for imaging neuroendocrinal tumors. These are the DOTATATE, DOTATOC, and DOTANOC. With different affinity, the most commonly used of which is the gallium dotatate, with selected and preferential affinity for somatostatin type 2. Gallium DOTA peptide PCT is, as Gabriel mentioned, is far advantageous over the somatostatin receptor using the octreotide because of the higher affinity for the somatostatin receptors, high resolution, quantitating the tracer uptake, which will help you in making decision regarding the treatment and predicting the therapeutic response. And another pitfall is the uptake in the uncinate process of the pancreas, which is a problem in this because most of the neuroendocrinal tumors may arise in this local. So you have to be that aware that the uncinate process may light up at the part of the physiological process. This is the patient with enhancing lesion in the pancreatic body, which lights up with the DOTA, NOC, PET CT, and it was proved to be a well-differentiated neuroendocrinal tumor. This is a gallium dotatate PET CT demonstrating activity within the interventricular system, and it was proved to be a neuroendocrinal tumor. I'm going to conclude with this slide. I will not go through that. يعني we covered the tracer. I'm not going to the details of each pathology. The last tracer is the non-specific. We mentioned the specific PET tracer. These are the non-specific PET tracer, the most famous of which is the FDG, F18 FDG PET, which is a glucose analog, particularly indicated for the MIBG negative tumors. An interesting phenomena associated with the FDG and the somatostatin receptor imaging, that the exchange roles. Some of the tumors are FDG active and somatostatin receptor negative. Some tumors are the reverse. So this is called the flip-flop phenomena, where high-grade and poorly differentiated neuroendocrinal tumor show a greater FDG uptake with a sensitivity of 92% or over 92% with proliferation index of 15% or more than 15%. Whereas low-grade and well-differentiated neuroendocrinal tumors overexpress somatostatin receptors, so they are somatostatin receptor positive, but FDG low uptake. However, this is not an absolute rule. Some differentiated tumors may do not express enough somatostatin receptors, and some aggressive, poorly differentiated tumors do not use glycolysis for metabolism. So there is always a problem at the end of the story. But to conclude, you need sometimes to perform both the FDG PET and the gallium DOTA imaging in order to have an insight about the biological behavior of the tumor and to decide how you will tackle it, surgery, chemoembolization, peptide receptor radionuclide therapy, chemotherapy. So you have to do both for the sake of the treatment, and thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Khalid, for scientific talking. Shukran, Yvesh.